Hi, everyone. Welcome to today's talk, hosted by the American University Counseling Center. My name is Bobby Ortega, and I'll be presenting today about sociopolitical behavior and mental health. Something that I want to quickly introduce before we get into the meat of the presentation is what today's talk is all about. Really what today's lecture is really supposed to discuss is the connections between sociopolitical behaviors and mental health. One of the other things that we're going to be exploring towards the end of the presentation is what are some of the ways that we can use this information to inform ways that we can engage in sociopolitical behaviors in a way that's really helpful, that can improve our engagement in sociopolitics and improve our mental health in the long run. One important thing to point out what today's lecture is not, it's not therapy. It's not a substitute for therapy. I am a clinician here at AUCC, but really today's lecture is more about information. It's about how it is that you can approach this stuff in a way that's really helpful for you and how you can engage in sociopolitical behaviors in a way that's that feels right with your values and also it helps promote your mental health. I think this is where the second part of the presentation or the main part of the presentation is going to kick in. But just to briefly introduce me, these are the points that I'll be talking about. I'm a doctoral student at the University of Oregon, completing my doctoral internship here at the American University Counseling Center. I'm originally from El Paso, Texas, and I actually went to undergrad out here in DC. Kind of moving out here is what got me really involved and engaged in kind of sociopolitics, whether it's relates to voting, whether it relates to marches, whether it relates to public discourse around politics. Really all of this started for me when I moved out to DC. And so this topic really has a soft spot in my heart and is certainly the core of my research right now. And a lot of that started when I was doing undergrad out here. And so I definitely appreciate just how much work, especially the students at American do in this realm. And so broadly, in terms of what we're going to be talking about, the kind of talk about theory, I don't want to get too far lost in theory, but I think it's interesting and worth noting. Talk about some of the previous research in terms of what previous outcomes have shown about the connections between these two concepts. And then talk about my research, because again, I am nothing if not self-aggrandizing. I think my stuff is really interesting. So I love talking about it. And then finally wrap up with what it is we can do, whether it has to do with sociopolitical behavior, whether it has to do with mental health, what are some things we can get involved with in order to make both of these domains better? So let's start off with theory. And I don't want to get lost in the woods of theory. There's tons of stuff we could talk about here. But one of the things that I think for a lot of people, as we try to figure out like the connection between these two things, is like understanding why theoretically these things would connect. And so very briefly, I want to talk about two theories that I really use a lot in this field. One of them is very much in like the mental health range. That's acceptance and commitment therapy. Within ACT, which is how we talked about it, or ACT, one of the big things that we talk about is like moving towards instead of moving away. I'm going to get to both the theories. I'm going to start with ACT. If you're looking at ACT from the broad sense, you're talking about six major concepts: acceptance, diffusion, selfless context, the present, committed action, and values. And for the work that I'm really talking about here, I'm going to talk about three of them. One of them is acceptance. Now, what is acceptance? It's not exactly what it sounds like. In some ways, a better way to describe acceptance is willingness or willfulness. Acceptance is all about figuring out the things that we can live with and what are the things that we must change in order to make our lives better. And this concept very much closely aligns with the two bottom concepts. To first name it, values. What are the things that matter to you? What are the things that, no matter what, you're going to support and that you are going to pursue because they hold meaning to you? If all of us are engaged in some sort of action, what's the direction that we want to head in? Because it holds important meaning. Also, another piece is called committed action. Committed action is all about like staying the course. Once we figure out what it is that matters to us and how we can engage in it, the next thing that we ask is like, how do we continue to engage in it? And committed action is all about that. There we go. So I'm going to use a quick vignette because I find these sometimes can be really helpful in terms of understanding how ACT works. Let's talk about a fictional client, completely made up. Although I'm willing to bet all of us have experienced this phenomenon at some point. Let's talk about Maria. Maria has a big assignment coming up in 3 weeks. It's a 12-page paper worth 50% of her overall grade in what she considers her most important class. She's so worried about it that every time she thinks about starting it, she gets overwhelmed and does something else. So sometimes she'll go and clean her house. Other times she'll go watch Netflix, which she doesn't even seem to enjoy all that much because while she's watching Netflix and watching her favorite shows, she ends up thinking about the assignment that she's not doing the whole time. Now, the big question, what should we do? Or rather, what should she do? What should Maria do? This might seem really straightforward, common sense, but ultimately from an ACT perspective, what we'd argue, she's gotta do the paper. Anxiety has a way of trying to get us to avoid things that scare us, but ACT is about moving towards those things. ACT says not only being done with that assignment going to feel good, but actually the accomplishment of moving towards the things that scare us actually make us feel more efficacious, make us feel stronger, and that we can continue with those actions going forward. So that's where the committed action piece comes in. Now, it's much easier to explain that with a homework assignment, which I think a lot of us can associate with. Everybody's procrastinated something at some point. But what about when it comes to these bigger political things? I can't just act and then suddenly change the entire course of an election in most years. So what are things we can do? Well, to get into that, I'm going to get into the other theory. Critical consciousness is a little bit less mental health oriented, and it's much more kind of sociologically oriented. If you were defining critical consciousness as Watts did in 2011, you might define it as how oppressed or marginalized people learn to critically analyze their social conditions and act to change them. In some ways, you might already be hearing a little bit of overlap in these two theories, but critical consciousness has these three big components: reflection, efficacy, and action. And basically what each of these is saying is like we have to, the critical reflection piece is understanding how different systems work. The efficacy piece is understanding how we can make change in those systems, and the action is going out and doing it. And so when we look at these two theories in tandem, I think they actually support one another quite a bit. When we talk about values and acceptance and commitment therapy, they actually sound a lot like reflection and agency, in that we're figuring out how systems work, how we interact with them, and what it is we can do about them. The acceptance piece very much aligns with critical agency or efficacy. Again, like what are the things that I want to do or that I don't think I need to do to make change, the changes that I want to see or the things that I can essentially just live with. And then finally, the committed action and the critical action very much reflect the same thing. How do I go out and make this happen and stay the course to make sure that I follow through? So that's the very basics of theory. And now get to the part that I'm actually here to talk about, is how do I apply these concepts to things like mental health? I do it through sociopolitical behaviors. Examples of these behaviors are voting, going out to marches or protests, public discourse, so talking with local leaders about issues that are popping up, and being engaged in policy making. So that could be something as simple as a school board meeting, town hall meetings, being engaged with policymakers as they're in action. So let's start off with what the research says, and I'm going to move fairly quickly through this just because I know we don't have a ton of time today. But if you want to hear more about this, you can always email me. I'll put up my contact info towards the end. But just some really, really basic outcomes that we've witnessed. Clients have shown really unprecedented reaction to the current administration. The biggest thing that is popping up and has been shown in the last few years, it's a really high level of anxiety. Part of this has to do with anxiety about the policies that are currently being put in place. But the thing that these two authors here, Panning and Stonsky found was people are getting more and more uncomfortable even discussing politics or discussing policy. And in some ways that makes a lot of sense. We're more polarized as a country than we've ever been. Being able to reach the other side is getting more and more difficult. A couple other authors that also found similar things. Americans show high level of anxiety discussing and even thinking about political matters, which just goes to show that right now, working in the kind of socio-political environment is an anxiety-provoking place. When we talk about like the two big outcomes that get studied in socio-political research and psychology, one is depression, one is anxiety. We can definitely see a lot of that popping up here. When it comes to AU students, I think about the fact that this is one of the most politically engaged student bodies in the country, if not the world. Many students come here to figure out what it is that they can do to change the country, to change the world. And in some ways, if you're experiencing anxiety around this, it makes it much more difficult to engage in this work, whether it's in the classroom, whether it's through student government or student organizations of any kind. And even going out into things like internships and trying to make the change while you're a student can be really difficult. And so I think it's really important that we understand this connection. One of the big behaviors that I've really been focusing on is voting and voter registration. So why focus on this one? Well, this is an area with a fair amount of research so far. For one, voting is ultimately the most powerful thing that United States citizen has in terms of making change on a policy level. As small as it can sometimes feel, it is ultimately the strongest tool that a citizen has in this country. So if you want to change things like structural inequality, social inequality, this is ultimately one of the strongest tools we have. Further, there's been a variety of bidirectional effects between mental illness with voting and non-voting. And you'll have to forgive that I have to look away for a second because I couldn't get my notes up on the screen, so I'm going to have to read off my paper. Several authors, including Ballard et al., found that civic engagement led to higher levels of positive mental health outcomes a year later. Young adults with higher levels of what we call flourishing, which is just kind of a broad measure of positive mental health outcomes, showed higher levels of socio-political behaviors 6 months later. Adolescents with higher level of civic engagement during high school showed significantly lower rates of depression in adulthood. People with higher levels of depression showed 1 year follow-up with lower rates of voting than the rest of the population, and then showed higher, those who did not vote 1 year after that showed higher levels of depression. When we talk about like the two big outcomes, when you talk about the broad socio-political behavior fields, anxiety tends to be the one big thing that pops up. But when it comes to voting, depression tends to be one of the things that really comes out most often. And one thing worth noting is that this year, due to COVID restrictions in terms of being on campus across the country, we're actually seeing lower rates of voter registration among young adults than we've ever seen in recorded history. And it has to do with the fact that the vast majority of people get registered to vote during young adulthood do so on a college campus and don't get those opportunities, aren't currently getting the same opportunities right now. And so here we are. I know I've rushed through the first half of this presentation or so, or the first third of it. But we know that that voting and socio-political engagement are connected to mental health outcomes in some ways. And we know that it's not happening on the same level that we'd like to in terms of getting young adults engaged in it. Which brings me to the research that I do, which is where I get really excited, obviously. First off, my dissertation. Yuck, it's brutal. If you just look at stats, this is probably very dry, uninteresting stuff. But I'm hoping to convince you by the end of the next couple of minutes as I talk about what this actually means, you find it a little bit more interesting. So if we're talking about this among humans, this is how I would describe it a little bit more, or a little bit more effectively. My dissertation is taking a sample of college students, 18 to 24 year old college students, and asked them about a bunch of different behaviors, especially depression and voting likelihood, exploring some of the connection between voting likelihood and and self-efficacy, specifically voting self-efficacy. So what that really means is, like, do you know where to register to vote? Do you know how to register to vote? Do you know where you can vote? Do you have an idea of, like, the issues that you're voting around? And then also exploring some of the differences by state, ethnicity, and gender. And the good news is I'm just wrapping up analyses right now. And so I can kind of share with y'all some knowledge that the rest of the world does not have, which is really exciting. These are some outcomes that are not necessarily finalized. I don't want to convince you that these are going to show in every other study from here on out. But these are some things that are standing out from my analyses as I'm doing them, hopefully to get published in the next year or so. So just like previous research has shown, there's a negative correlation between depression and voting likelihood. That means that the people in my survey who were filling out answers indicating that they were experiencing higher levels of depression were also indicating that they were less likely to vote. Voting likelihood was also strongly correlated with voting self-efficacy. This one's not a huge surprise either. If you don't know a lot of things about, like, where to register to vote or how to vote, you're probably less likely to go out and vote. Where it gets really interesting, at least to me, is that we start finding differences by state, ethnicity, and gender that I think are actually quite profound. So one of the big things that the study looks to be showing is that these effects don't remain the same across state lines. States with who make it easier to vote, so states that automatically make voter registration, make voting by mail the expected norm, voting self-efficacy doesn't actually play that big of a part. Because people are already engaged, already know how to send in their ballots, and don't need to find all the information to engage in it. And as such, they're more likely to vote in general, regardless of what their self-efficacy was. Further, it actually negates some of the effect of depression on voting likelihood. So even those people who are finding finding it more difficult to kind of muster the energy to figure out the policy decisions affected by their vote, these people are still fairly likely to vote in states where the cost of voting is considered lower. When it comes to ethnicity, actually for Latinos, which is one of the big samples that I'm focusing on, depression doesn't have as big of an impact on voting likelihood as it does for the rest of the population, specifically white or European American folks. In fact, the voting self-efficacy piece is even more prominent among this population, which tells us something about if we want to get specific populations engaged in voting behaviors, we need to really focus on what it is that motivates them to vote and figures out and that demonstrates what's more likely to get them to turn out to vote. And finally, by gender, the self-efficacy piece is actually less important for women than it is for men. And actually what's more important for young women appears to be the depression piece. Young women who endorse higher levels of depression are less likely to be engaged in voting this November than those with lower levels of depression. And so this kind of just shows us that in all the different populations that we're talking about, we need to be aware of the different effects of mental health and voting. One thing for us to name in this is also presumed to be a bi-directional relationship. If you're less likely to vote, you're probably gonna know less about the voting process and thus have lower self-efficacy. Vice versa, that's also true with voting and depression. Again, if you're more depressed, you're less likely to vote. Which is likely going to make you more depressed in the long run because you're not engaging in the behaviors to try to change the world around you in the way that ACT supports. The other piece of research that I want to talk about is this program called ALES, which I've just finished wrapping, or I just wrapped up working with about 6 months ago. ALES is probably the coolest thing that I've ever done. ALES is, it stands for Advocating for Latino Achievement in School. Its interventions focus on a couple different things. Primarily, it's critical consciousness, that theory that we were talking about earlier. And it's really oriented for students to pursue higher education. We're using a lot of the same language here that we were using for the dissertation, but we're also focusing on self-efficacy and confidence within education. And the basic idea of the group was, we had us graduate students, so I think all of us were PhD students in counseling psychology, going to a local school out in Oregon, which is where I was working on the PhD. For a little bit of background information, Latino students in Oregon have really low rates of graduation. Within 5 years, the only about 56% of Latinos in Oregon are expected to graduate year to year, which is an incredibly low number by pretty much any metric. And so our goal here was to try to figure out how can we help with that and what kinds of changes can we help make. The way we did that was providing homework help. So it's a 2-hour intervention. The first hour is literally just us working on tutoring, which involved me learning a lot about Algebra 2 that I hadn't talked about since I was a high school senior, probably junior, which was difficult, but always an interesting experience for me. The second part was the part where we really bring in self-efficacy and critical consciousness, especially. We really focused on exploring identity and talking about structural inequality and how it is that different groups of people around the world get to where they're at. The big components of that second part of the intervention were academic support and career development. So exploring what's it like to apply for college, what are some resources in terms of finding scholarships, building community and universality. And so part of this is just like building a group, finding ways that people can connect, sharing one another's story or our own stories about how it is that our families came to be here, developing advocacy skills. So how to respond to problematic things that we see in our community, enhancing cultural pride, talking about stories that don't typically get talked about in the typical American educational system. And finally, increasing critical consciousness. So things like knowing your rights if police arrive at your door, recognizing stereotypes as they arise in our lives, and exploring our cultural family histories of how it is that we grow and how it is that we promote justice among the people that we care about. Also, there's obviously a research component to this. So the big outcomes that we were looking at were really focused on increasing self-efficacy, advocacy skills, school engagement, mental health outcomes, and grades. And I talked a little bit already about how it is that we're going about pursuing these things. So some of the outcomes. And again, we're actually in the process of publishing a second and third paper on this. The third one is going to have all of our big outcomes, which we're very excited about. But some of the big things that we saw as we were talking about critical consciousness. Overall, grades increased over time, not only within the student, but compared to their peers, so other Latino students at the school. Dropout risk was significantly lower than it was for the overall Latinx population. So as a matter of fact, all of our students who engaged with at least 4 sessions of ALES have maintained being on track to graduate or have graduated, which when you consider that the overall rate of graduation for Latinos in Oregon is slightly over 50%, is pretty encouraging. Graduation rate slightly higher or significantly higher than the overall Latinx population. Like I mentioned, every student that we've had who showed up for at least 4 sessions has either been on track to graduate or has graduated. And finally, school attendance increased relative to other students. These are just like the school and mental health outcomes, or just the school outcomes. But the kind of community activism and mental health outcomes are actually also very encouraging. And I'm just realizing, I think I forgot to put them in here, but I actually know most of them off the cuff because I've been doing the analysis recently. Overall, rates of depression are lower amongst our students, both compared to when they arrived at LS, so pre-post, as well as compared to the control sample that we have at the school. And so are overall rates of anxiety. Those are also improved, which is useful when we think about like the connection between mental health and sociopolitical behavior. By knowing how to engage in these structures and knowing how it is that we can make changes in communities, if we think back to that, again, that ACT perspective, by us engaging in the things that are difficult, us engaging in the things that worry us, not only do we make changes in those things, but we feel better about our ability to do it, which is a very valuable skill. The last thing that I really wanted to talk about in today's talk is, okay, great. There's a connection between these two things. We have an idea of how to make them happen. What do we do here? What do we do here at AU in DC? What do we do as young adults trying to engage in this work? And these are just a bunch of ideas. I think I wanted to start off primarily with information because I think that's valuable, and then kind of getting into more of what it is that we can do more pragmatically. A few of these websites are really basic stuff. I'm willing to bet you all have explored some aspect of this already. But the first one is just vote.org, focusing on whether or not you're registered to vote. Can tell you in any of the states, including the District of Columbia, whether or not you're registered and whether or not you can do that. I think in most states, this is already just passed us in the last few weeks, but worth looking into if you haven't already still. If you are registered to vote, exploring absentee voting. If you're currently here in DC, but registered in another state, exploring if you can get an absentee ballot and how it is that you can do that, really valuable. This right here is the National Council on Policy, really focused on how it is that affecting big policy changes can affect mental health services and vice versa. So by encouraging more positive use in mental health services, we can actually promote more equitable policy decisions. And then finally, this is really just more for providers, but like, how is it that we get people who are engaged in mental health services? So like my clients at the AUCC, how do we get them involved in like improving the overall quality of mental health services through political action? Because that's also a very important piece. Now on to what it is that we can more pragmatically do. And this is something that I really like sharing with folks who are currently experiencing anxiety around the election. We've got 15 days until November 3rd, which is going to be one of the most important elections of any of our lifetimes. How can we impact it in a positive way, whether not just through our votes, but like also supporting the democratic process in a way that makes this more equitable for everyone? So one thing that I recommend for a lot of folks is consider volunteering as an election worker. A lot of places are understaffed in terms of voting, in terms of counting votes, in terms of making sure that the lines are running smoothly. And volunteering as an election worker can make a really big difference, not only in terms of like helping your local government run its election effectively and equitably, but also just like getting that feeling that you're doing something, which is really what this page is all about. If you're like, you know what, I don't know if I have the time to really volunteer as an election worker and put in all the time that that might take, also consider volunteering as a poll watcher. What this is a much smaller time commitment. And literally what you're doing is just making sure that everything is going the way that it's supposed to. Again, helping people through line, making sure that as ballots are being transported, they're being done properly. For a lot of us, I know a great deal of us are not necessarily comfortable being out in crowds right now, which makes sense even with a mask. So a couple of options that also exist for people that aren't necessarily as comfortable doing the work in public is these last two. One of these is joining the U.S. Voters Hotline. And so by doing this, what you're doing is you're able to provide information for people if they arrive at their polling station and it turns out that their polling station is closed for some reason, or that there's something interrupting polling there. By being able to report this, you're actually able to help, in some cases, keep polling places open later, or help local districts make sure that people who are in line are able to find a place where they can vote. And finally, another big piece is just helping make calls to recruit voter protection volunteers. So that could be election workers or poll watchers. Vote.org has a really excellent team of people who's committed to just making sure that our democratic process runs properly. And so signing up with them in terms of these pieces can be really effective in terms of making broad scale change, making sure that, again, our election process goes smoothly and effectively, and also feeling like you're the one going out and helping making change, which is an important piece. The last thing that I wanted to talk about is AUCC. I wanted to just do a quick plug in terms of potentially needing services. I know for a lot of us, we're carrying a lot of anxiety, worry, concern about the upcoming election. And if you're at a place where you're wondering like, hey, I feel like I could really use talking to somebody. Maybe I just need a quick sit down to just process my worries with. This is just your basic information. You can call us and make an initial consultation if you want to talk to somebody regularly, or even just utilize our urgent care as a drop-in. Our urgent care is available 2 to 4 p.m. on weekdays, any day that we're open during the week. Our initial consultation, you can call in and we'll schedule you for more ongoing sessions. But I mentioned with urgent care, you can just click on this link and you can drop in any day of the week between 2 and 4 and be seen by one of our clinicians. And just one last thing that I wanted to share from this slide is if you find yourself in a really intense crisis, you're getting overwhelmed with what's going on, which again is a pretty reasonable response to our current political situation. I also encourage you to utilize our off after hours call center, which is protocol, which you can reach at the number at the bottom left here. This is again just the website in order to reach us. And I want to wrap up with asking if there are any questions. I know I moved through really quickly, but I wanted to make sure that we left a few minutes to make sure that we could discuss anything that I moved through too quickly. So I want to open the floor to any questions that anybody has about the presentation, about the research.
Hi, I have a question. I'm curious about the role. Okay, so I don't know if it's a question as much as it is a point of a discussion / question.
That's all my questions too. Don't worry.
But I'm thinking about the role of self-efficacy and the ability, the feeling that I am able to do something. And the ways in which overall, like depression, part of depression is that self-efficacy piece. And part of what, okay, so I'm a clinician. So part of the role that we do is we try to increase a person's self-efficacy. And it sounds like if you're able to take overall care of your mental health, then you're able to engage in some of these processes. But also it sounds like the reverse is true also. If you're engaging in some of these processes, it also helps to increase your self-efficacy, which then increases your positive mental health outcomes. So I don't know if that's a question or a point of discussion. No,
absolutely. I think that's a really great point that these things are, they're bidirectional and increasing one or promoting one promotes the other, right? So in some ways going out and acting is how we build up that self-efficacy. And by going out, acting upon this thing, building up our self-efficacy, that's how we can affect depression, right? That's the fundamentals of any cognitive behavioral theory of depression is sometimes you just have to act and then the symptom reduction follows. And at the same time, if we can act first in one of the other domains, in some ways that's how we affect our actions. So maybe building up self-efficacy, learning about where it is that I can register to vote, where it is that I vote, where it is that I can sign up to volunteer. That then increases the chance that I engage in those behaviors, and then through there, we're able to change symptomology. And so absolutely, by doing one of these, we're doing all of these. That's a really great point.
Bobby, I'm wondering if you could, I think Amanda has a question. I see her hand is raised. why don't you go first?
Are you sure?
Yes, please. Go ahead, Amanda.
Okay, great. Well, first of all, thank you so much for this. I learned a lot. This was really just informative and super, super helpful. So thank you for doing this.
Thank you.
And I think my question builds off of the previous question, I think. And it's sort of related to this idea of self-efficacy and sort of localizing it to our AU context. And something I've observed and curious about. So many of our students are politically engaged, right? And they're also very interested in taking on big, knotty structural challenges. And the challenge with that is often that to be effective in your efforts takes time. It's harder to get a win, right? A small win if what you're trying to do is take down structural racism, for example, right? So I guess I'm curious about the importance of self-efficacy in the sense of I did what it is I set out to do versus I tried to do something and I didn't make that happen. And how do those two different outcomes inform mental health?
I think that's a great point, Amanda. Thank you for bringing that up. And actually, it brings me back to a piece on critical consciousness that I think is pretty valuable here. One of the things that we see, like overall, if your rate of critical consciousness goes up, your mental health outcomes tend to be better. But there is one exception to that. And that is if your critical reflection, like your knowledge of systems keeps increasing, but like your efficacy of knowing how to change it doesn't, it actually makes everything worse. Right? Which probably isn't that surprising. If all we're experiencing is, all we're getting is like a further understanding of how bad things are, and we don't feel like we're able to make that change, in time that actually makes it worse, which I think is a feeling that we can all empathize with, is like, yeah, I know stuff's bad. I know it's unfair. I know oppression's out there. I know that it's negatively affecting lots of people. I can tell you 10 examples of how that's played out in the national news this week. But if all we're doing is consuming that information and we're not able to find ways to like act upon that, then it actually in some ways can increase problematic mental health outcomes. And so part of it is like figuring out how to find the balance between these things. And one of the things that I actually I'll recommend for a lot of students in this regard is turning down the rate that we're intaking a lot of this information. Because if all you do is you consume media on like how bad these systems are, obviously it's super important to be well-informed, but there comes a point where that only just becomes more problematic and prevents us from acting upon things. Increasing rates of anxiety, increasing rates of depression, which then in turn decreases our ability to act upon these systems. So in some ways it's about like prioritizing your mental health as a political action, prioritizing your own well-being and your own happiness day to day as in some ways a revolutionary action of being engaged in politics. Because ultimately, like the way social media works nowadays, you can just sit there and consume all the bad news all day nonstop. And in the long run, you're actually gonna do even less as a result. I hope that addresses the question, Amanda. I tend to talk very long-windedly about these sorts of things.
I really loved what you said there around kind of radical self-care, right? I actually used that quote early today. I'm glad to know that's actually founded in something. And I think my follow-up, and this doesn't have to be addressed now because I think Daniel had a question too, but I guess I'm curious about how do we advise students around chunking off pieces of big structures that you can impact more easily, right? In terms of not just what do we consume in terms of our our social media intake, but what are we what are we doing and what are we acting upon? And how do we kind of not see that as selling out? Because I think that's how a lot of our students experience it. Like, if I'm not taking down the whole system, I'm somehow allowing the system to be okay, or I'm selling out, right? But instead say, what piece of this system can you, is proximal to you, and can you make change upon? And is that sort of a, I don't know, I'm thinking out loud with you as to whether that might be a more pro-health strategy.
Amanda, I think that's absolutely spot on as well. I think for a lot of college students around the country, I mean, I'll name, when I was starting undergrad myself, I was of the exact same mindset. We need to take the whole thing down. We need to change it all right now. And in some ways, that's like correct, right? Like that, we do need to make those changes. We do need to completely flip that aspect of our society's upside down and really affect change right away. And recognizing that these systems are like built to maintain themselves in some ways, lends an idea of like, we need to figure out like, where is it that we can each individually have impact, and then coalesce around those areas. I wish I had the correct answer for it. If I did, I think we'd have systemic racism and sexism figured out. I promise I'd be letting everybody know. But ultimately, I think that mindset alone is the solution here. Like helping people figure out where it is that they have that self-efficacy. I know, I'll use an example for myself. I know I have the ability to connect with people. I know that that's just one of my gifts that I developed from an early age for whatever reason. And so when I have these talks, and I'll name, I prefer giving them in person because of this, but I know I can help get people to come together around these sorts of projects and these sorts of ideas, whether that's talking individually or to talking to small groups. I know that's just like one of the things I do well. So I love organizing. I love getting people together around things. For some people, they're great social media marketers around this sort of stuff. So like not only finding the right subject material and specific subject material that we can focus on and change, but also figuring out like, where is it that we're really efficacious so that we can be the ones who drive that change?
Thank you, Bobby. Actually, you kind of already answered some of the question I was gonna ask was around self-care. You already mentioned one way that students can engage in self-care, and I'm curious if there are any other strategies I know you as an ACT clinician could talk about, and how students can engage in self-care in regards to the social political situation.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you know, we use this word self-care a lot in mental health, and I think it's absolutely critical. I mean, there are lots of different ways to engage in self-care. From an ACT perspective, a lot of it has to do with like intentionality. All of us have probably had that experience of like watching, whether it's Netflix or YouTube or whatever it is that we're doing to like blow off steam. And we find ourselves like my made up case example, Maria, worrying about the big assignment that we've got, right? One of the big things that I recommend from an ACT perspective is kind of intentionality. I'm gonna block off the next hour and a half and I'm just gonna watch my favorite show. Is it changing structural inequality? No. For the next hour, I'm not going to be an agent of change other than for myself. And within that, just like focusing on how it is that we can individually take care of ourselves. Some of us that's going on a run. Some of us that's reading a book. Some of us that's just hanging out with our roommates. But whatever it is that like helps you feel engaged and refreshed afterwards in a way that makes you feel like more motivated to be engaged in other parts of your life. That's, as an ACT clinician, the stuff that we want you pursuing constantly. I want to say thank you for all the great questions here. I think we probably should be wrapping up because I know we do only have the 5 to 6 o'clock hour. But I do want to share, I'm just going to put it in the chat, Danny, if that's all right, my email address.
Sure.
Okay, I'm just gonna go ahead and throw that in there. If anybody has any other questions, comments, concerns, I'm more than happy to continue talking about it. This is something very near and dear to my heart. So I could definitely talk about this all day. So thank you all for coming and listening.